Goosen dropping for Rios. Rios shoved off the ball, and they point to the spot.
Welcome to Instant Replay presented by Cheez-It. I'm Andrew Wiebe. That's Bobby Warshaw. This is a Kick Childhood Cancer hat. So before we get to the controversial plays, a PSA for you. When you tweet your vitriol, your hate, or, Bobby, their approval? No, probably not their approval. Use the hashtag KickChildhoodCancer, $1 every time you do that to the Children's Oncology Group. Let's go.
Here we go, straight into Children's Mercy Park for Sporting and Portland. It's the 35th minute of a 1-1 game. Brian Fernandez is out on the break, and Felipe Gutierrez brings him down. Gutierrez has a little something to say after, which I think ties back to this interaction between the two in the 27th minute. Gutierrez was fouled by Sebastian Blanco, and Fernandez walked over to Gutierrez to give his 2 cents. It clearly triggered something in the Sporting midfielder because Gutierrez didn't forget it. So the temperatures are raised as Fernandez bounces up after the Gutierrez foul and gets in Gutierrez's face. Referee Alan Chapman gives a yell to each player immediately, but it didn't end there. When there's a Sporting scuffle, you know who's coming. Roger Espinoza runs in and the brouhaha augments. Even Gio and Vermees get involved. I'd listen to that podcast. As things cool down, Chapman decides to change the yellow to Fernandez to a straight red and then head to the video screen to get more information. He returns, keeps the Fernandez red, and gives Espinoza a red as well for this hand to the neck on Blanco. Tough to argue with that one. It is, and I don't know if this earns champagne or not, Espinoza's MLS record-breaking 11th red card in his career, according to Paul Carr. The red given to Fernandez is a little bit more questionable, though. It was reported that the fourth official told the sideline reporter that the Timbers attacker received red for this headbutt. I'm not sure that one's worthy of expulsion. Neither is this hand to the back of Gutierrez's head, which I would categorize as negligible contact. We'll see if that red card is upheld and whether Fernandez will be eligible for Decision Day presented by AT&T in a game the Timbers cannot lose to San Jose if they want to be in the playoffs.
And those weren't even the first controversial calls of the game. The Timbers have felt hard done by recently, and they had a right to feel that way after Christian Namath's opener thanks to this magnificent whipped-in ball from Johnny Russell. When you watch it live, there are hints of offside, but Russell is hiding outside the frame. When you see this angle, courtesy of the Timbers broadcast, there is no doubt, in my mind at least, he's offside. To me, and yes, angles can play tricks, Russell is beyond the last defender when the ball is played. In my opinion, this ought to have been reviewed and reversed.
Fast forwarding ahead again now to the end of the second half. Sporting are leading 2-1 at this point. Blanco slips the ball through to Jeremy Abobasi, and Ilya Sanchez gives the attacker a yank on the shoulder. Chapman points to the spot straight away. For me, it's a good penalty call. The contact isn't much, but it's enough to impact the play. And because it wasn't in action on the ball by Ilya, Chapman shows him the dog so red so. Portland score the penalty, the final 10 minutes are played 10-9, and the game finishes 2-2.
Oh, boy, a lot going on there. Must-win game for San Jose at Avaya Stadium as well. Game is scoreless in the 54th minute when the Quakes, Tommy Thompson, and Sounder Xavier Arriaga go mano a mano down in the corner. The AR flags for a foul on Thompson, and referee Ismael Elfath blows his whistle. But something happens to Arriaga here after the play is dead. Watch him react and roll around, but what happened? It's hard to see live until we get a replay, and that's a kick out slash stomp from Thompson back into Arriaga's leg. Elfath does what the laws require of him and shows the red card. Zero doubt here for me, that is the correct call. That's violent conduct, same as Christian Espinoza a week ago.
Quick one up in Montreal now. It's 1-1 in the 83rd between the Impact and Atlanta United when it appears that Tito Villalba has given Atlanta the lead. Shout out to that saucy chip from Ezequiel Barco there too. But after video review, Jair Marufo finds that Justin Miram was in an offside position on the initial shot by Barco, so the goal comes back. Nice use of video review there, the game finished tied. Another good offside call in Utah. Albert Elise appears to put Houston ahead of RSL in the first half, but the flag had gone up. Here's the still image on the final touch from Tomas Martinez. It's not a great angle, but it looks like Elise is beyond the last defender. It's an impressive call from assistant referee Brian Dunn, who got it right live. RSL would go on to win 2-1.
To BMO Field we go for a foul call that took a Jozy Altidore goal off the board. 14th minute, game is scoreless. Justin Morrow floats a ball into the box for the big man, and Francisco Calvo gets tight to keep Altidore from winning the header. Altidore returns in kind, as you do, wins the header, despite Calvo's efforts, and then bangs in the rebound. Goal! Wait, goal? No goal. Referee Kevin Stock calls the foul on Altidore, and I think that's the right call. Both these guys are battling, but Altidore extends both arms and literally moves Calvo with his leg strength. Notice, Jozy barely complains here. That says it all to me.
I gotta say, I love when Jozy goes into beast mode.
And that was beast mode.
Let's stop over at Red Bull Arena with DC United in town. There's a home playoff game on the line here. 18th minute, game scoreless. Lucas Rodriguez is played through and is in a foot race with Red Bull's defender, Tim Parker. The two tumble and referee Remy Touchon calls a foul for DC. Parker could be in trouble of dog so red so here. After some deliberation with the assistant referee Ian Anderson, however, Touchon changes the call and awards the free kick to Red Bull. For me, it's a great decision from Touchon and a fantastic eye from Anderson on the sideline. Look at the close-up. At the moment of contact, Parker is slightly ahead of Rodriguez. It's Rodriguez who runs into the back of Parker. Excellent defending from Parker and the right call in the end. The defender stays on the field and the game would finish 0-0. DC go into decision day, 1 point ahead of Red Bull for the fourth seed.
All right, let's jump in our instant replay time machine.
That Cheez-It budget on point, huh, Wiebe?
Yeah, it is. That is a time machine noise. To take a closer look at some calls from Wednesday night. First, where else? Back to Timbersland. Portland were leading the Revs 2-0 and looked like they could be on their way to basically locking down a playoff spot. But then they gave up the first goal, leading to this. Game is 2-1 Timbers. The ball comes into the box in the 96th minute. Steve Clark collects it and the game ends a few seconds later, but upon blowing the final whistle, referee Jaron Rufo signals that he's going to go look at the screen. For what, you ask? This tug from Larry's Maviala on Wilfred Zahibo. That's what he's looking at, and it's spotted by VAR Jose Carlos Rivero. Rufo calls the PK on review, Carlos Hill goes to the spot, and it's a point apiece. It's the right call. Maviala got lazy and yanked the jersey instead of defending. Doesn't matter that Clark is going to gobble this up anyway. And no, Timbers fans, this is not too much stoppage time. Gio Savarese made two subs at the beginning of stoppage time. I timed it out. This is exactly right. The play should stand, and still Portland are hopping mad. Why? Because they remembered another jersey tug in the box in the 76th minute. Watch. Jeremy Abobase is around the back to potentially make it 2-0, and Brandon Bye has a fist full of jersey. Live, I got why it wasn't called. It's not as, quote-unquote, obvious as the Mabiala tug. Abobase's reaction isn't as dramatic, and the time of game doesn't make the call seem so life or death. But it's still a hold on a player to keep them from scoring. For me, considering all the context and the laws, that's a penalty too. That's no consolation for the Timbers, though.
Why did you put obvious in quotes?
Because it's not clear and obvious to everybody, Bobby.
I still don't know what that means, but we'll move on. So the door is open for the Quakes to get that playoff spot in the West. They are at home and pushing for an equalizer against the Union. Every point matters in the scrap for that last spot. It looks like the Quakes would get a chance from the spot in the 81st as Andres Rios gets brought down by Aurelian Colon in the box. Baltimore Toledo points for a PK immediately. First, cue up that Aurelian Colon. What, me? Face. So good every time. Sorry, Aurelian. This, for me, is a clear PK. Colon isn't playing the ball. He doesn't own possession of this ball. He's just desperately trying to stop the attacker. But Toledo decides he wants to go to the screen and take another look. As it was happening, I thought it would be a quick check and he would get back and keep the call on the field. But he returns and overturns the decision. He decides that this is a clear and obvious error and shouldn't be a penalty. I couldn't believe it then. I still don't understand it and can't believe it now. It was a PK for me live. It was a PK after video review. It was a huge call as the Quakes lost 2-1 and still sit below the playoff line heading into that final weekend Decision Day presented by AT&T. Andrew, what is your best of Relly and Colin? What, me face?
This one right here. Oh, tweet the hashtag, we'll see you.